many souls or ghosts over the years that I must inform that they are not animated in life anymore. And you might say, well, how would they not be aware of that? That doesn't make any sense, right? And the best way that I can describe it, especially when I'm teaching students to do spirit rescue work or psychopomp work, is they are in a bit of a state of confusion. Have you ever interacted maybe with a loved one or, a friend that may be struggling mentally with cognition, maybe Alzheimer's or some dementia? Mm-hmm. It's a very similar experience when you are in communication with a soul that's departed the body but isn't aware that they've passed.
I'd like to welcome back to the show, returning champion, Marianne Kennedy. How are you doing, Marianne?
I'm good, Alex. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you so much for coming back on the show. Our last conversation resonated a little bit with some people, and to say the least. So it's been, I said, well, I have to have her back. So thank you so much for coming back on the show.
Thanks for having me. I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, and also, you're also now being translated into multiple languages. So now you're getting people from around the world calling you for sessions that
Yes. You
can't do because you don't speak Spanish, German, French, Portuguese.
That's right. I mean, I've always worked with folks all over the globe, but primarily in English. So, we're working on how to accommodate that beyond, you know, a singular translation app, which is a little bit difficult given the work that I do. And we have, you know, specific time periods together, and translation apps sometimes don't work on demand as well as you want them to.
I think within the next 5 or 10 years, we'll look back at that kind of problem and laugh. They're like, oh, look at that. They couldn't even translate real time. Oh, God. But we'll get
right,
there.
And I hope you're right.
I hope so too. I think it's opening up the world to this kind of information, which is what we're trying to do with the show, is to try to really get it out there to a lot of people who just don't speak English. So, but anyway, so today, first of all, for people who don't know who you are and what you do, can you tell everybody a little bit of what you do and who you are?
Sure. My name is Marianne Kennedy, of course.
Yes.
I'm a psychic medium. I primarily work in mediumship, so I've done this for a number of years. And so I communicate with people on the other side, people who have passed, departed loved ones, and make those connections between them and their people here. I do a lot of teaching. So I teach mediumship and psychic development. I have 2 best-selling books. The first is How to Become a Medium, a step-by-step guide to connecting with the other side. And my most recent book, which was released last year, oh my gosh, time is really flying, isn't it? Is Advanced Mediumship. And it's a masterful guide for the practicing medium. I'm in the process of writing my 3rd book. It actually just started. I just started that process. So I've been doing that writing. And I work with folks all over the globe, both in mediumship, so making contact to the other side for other folks, and also in, soul-rooted or soul-based coaching, as well as psychic and intuitive guidance. So I work with a lot of folks who are a little bit stuck on their journey or don't know what's coming next or, you know, aren't sure about trajectory. And I just present clarity and options for them from a more universal perspective. That's sort of what I do. And I'm in Canada. And it's
right.
Snowing.
As it does in Canada.
As it does in Canada.
But Marianne, I have to ask you, where's your crystal ball? You don't look like a psychic at the side of a carnival. So that's one of the reasons why I love having you on the show, is because you kind of break the mold, the stereotype mold of this, like, you know, I see your future, that kind of like really caricature of what you do.
Yeah.
I mean, you look absolutely, the way you present yourself, the way you dress, your environment, you look like a psychologist, a therapist of some sort. Like, mm-hmm. You do not, like, what I think of psychic or psychic medium, no less, I think of Whoopi Goldberg from Ghost.
I know. That's funny. We're on the same wavelength. I thought of Whoopi Goldberg this morning from the movie Ghost. Isn't that funny?
It works.
It's something I hear a lot. I have in some ways, I'm very aware of what, stigma is around psychics and around mediums. I grew up like a psychic kid. I didn't practice mediumship, but I was very interested in, tarot cards and, nature spirits and, lucid dreaming and the psychic field and all of these things. And I think part of the reason that I, in my, adult and professional life as a medium, I normalize what it is that we do, not necessarily through intention. It's just over years and years, and I know that you can relate to this, what's initially supernatural, incredible to someone else, if it becomes part of your daily interaction and the way you interface with both the physical world and non-physical reality, it all becomes very normal. But I'm very aware of the stigma that can go along with it, and it's so important to me to be, one of the folks who has the privilege of being public in the work that I do to break that mold, because there are a lot of people, so many folks, whether you're a psychic, a medium, just sensitive, if you're empathic, they are afraid to claim that power because of what over, hundreds of years of history have thrown at us, as being sensitive people. And I think that we're not different. I think we're normal. And I think other people that are not sensitive are also normal. So it's so important to me to not feed in to a stereotype and to claim who I am as I am, doing what I do and who I am and how I look doing it. And I'm comfortable in that. And I encourage that to normalize who we are as sensitive people. Even language is important. I work with a lot of students, and new students I work with sometimes come to the table, when they introduce themselves in a group setting. They'll say, I'm a little bit woo-woo. And even that word, I really want to bring light to it. I want to shine spotlight on, I want to bring wisdom and insight to this word. Historically speaking, it's like different than strange, weird, the weird ones, the woo-woo people. And I don't want to claim that, because it's such a disempowering term if you really think about it. Even choosing the language we use to describe ourselves is so important. And so I know I don't look like a stereotypical psychic medium. And so my two responses to that is, in some ways I am that way because of the stigma. So it was very important to me as a young person to not be seen in doing what I did because it was so different. So I stayed presenting normal at the surface. And then the other is just my own evolution of my own power. This is always, this is what I look like and sound like. And I also do this thing, and I don't need to fit into a mold for someone to recognize that. I'll hold my power the way that I am, including looking the way that I do. Another part to that, of course, is that outside of my spiritual life, I am an educated person outside of the world of spirituality. And I did work in that field of education for a lot of years. And I sort of straddled both. I did my spiritual type work and also worked in the ordinary world and eventually shifted out of that. But I think whether it's formal or not, I think education is important for anyone who is in a position of, helping to lead others. And as I say, the education doesn't have to be institutionalized, but continued learning, continued education is important. And when we are in that position of continued education and learning, I think that becomes obvious when we present ourselves to whomever it is that we're speaking to.
Yes, absolutely. And again, that's one of the things I try to do on the show is to break stigmas between channelers and psychic mediums and near-death experiencers and even NASA rocket scientists who come on to talk about woo-woo, sorry, stuff about things like that, because it's a very important message to get out there that this was once considered very outlier, is becoming much more mainstream. Than it used to be. Much, much more
Yeah,
mainstream. The people like you
absolutely.
doing the work you're doing in the way that you're doing it is, I think, benefiting humanity in a large way. So I like to shine lights on people doing that.
That's great. And I feel like a big message of the work that I do in my teaching capacity is, if people want to, if students would like to use me as a model, or if someone listening to an interview that I'm doing might use me as a model, I like to sort of, like, if I distill it into essence, it's so many years now, but when I step into this work, I do so without requiring an invitation from anyone else. I claim my position in this world and my own soul in this world as I am. And I don't require someone else to approve of that, and I don't require an invitation. I will, act discerningly and intelligently to present where I'm needed and when I'm needed and how I'm needed. But I don't need anyone to grant me that opportunity as a human in this world. And that's important because when we if we play small as a psychic or as a medium or a sensitive person or an empath, then we tend to require someone else creating a space for us. But I'm not waiting for that. I've created my own, and I think we all have to create our own. I think we have to claim our own power, and we can do that, without being callous or harsh about it. We can do it with such conviction and knowingness that we're here to do something, and I'm going to fulfill that purpose, whether or not, a single person over here, over here, over here doesn't really like it. It's not really, that's really not my issue.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, no one gave me permission to start this show. And I just like, and trust me, it was, I'm sure as it was for you, which we talked about a lot in the first episode, coming out of that closet was not easy. But once you break through that wall, it's very liberating.
Usually liberating. Good word.
So I wanted to talk. So as of right now, there is this eclipse coming. This eclipse coming on April 8th. As of this recording, it has not happened yet. I would love to hear your point of view on, because there's a lot of fear around it. Of course, it's like 2012, is the Mayan calendar, is 9, this Y2K, it's all this kind of insanity. I'd love to hear the other side's point of view on what's going to happen on April 8th, and specifically spiritually, vibration, frequency for humanity, or are we just done on the 8th? So, is it over? Should I just cash out my 401k and head over to Bermuda? Like, is that what we should do? So tell me, what do you think?
I always like to take universal occurrences, as opportunities for us. I mean, we are here incarnate and in form, to experience duality, to experience the expression of spirit into form, into life. And I like to take these universal occurrences or changes in the season or, an eclipse or another type of event as sort of like a symbolic marker to make a pivot or to make a shift, make it like an invitation to myself to change something, to mark that occasion by some sort of, evolution of self, clearing of self. I like to take what specifically is going on the planet and replicate that in spiritual terms, because it's easy to understand a concept. When we think about going into Halloween, for example, or the fall harvest, everything is dying away, going dormant until we come into the spring. So I like to attune myself to those things because it's opportunities for us to also work with our own selves in cycles and create like significant moments of, you can call it ritual or planned action, whatever that looks like. So when I think about the eclipse, I would think to myself and talk to students about, what opportunity, what does it mean to you, right, to go into total darkness? What does that mean to you spiritually? What opportunity is being presented for you? What I like to think of when I think about the eclipse is, and it might sound a little counterintuitive, but sometimes we have work within ourselves to be done that we don't want to share with other people, that we don't want other people to see, where we really want to operate in our own darkness so that illumination isn't brought outward because it's really an inner job. It's an inner process and it's extremely vulnerable. So when I think about the eclipse, and we actually just talked about this in a class recently, I think about bringing ourselves into that really deep, honest moment or moments with ourselves to say, what needs to be reorganized here? What needs to be looked at? What needs to be, in some cases, obliterated or known better so that I can have that deep, vulnerable moment with no spotlight, that I can be really with the maybe the, sometimes the darkest or worst parts of myself or my experience. And let me do it like without shame or without, spectator. Let me do that on my own. And then let me, following that process of either examination, letting go, integrating, learning, whatever that might be, whatever I do in that shadow time, let me come into my own light after that. So that's what, in terms of a ritualistic opportunity for us, that's what I would look for in an event like the solar eclipse that we're having. From a humanity perspective, I have no inclination or indication, spiritually speaking, that anything remarkable in terms of destruction is occurring for us.
Really? No comet? No. Nope.
No 2K, like none of that is
Obviously, of
occurring
course.
on my radar.
Sure.
And but this is what I also say. This is what I say is that if we come to know something as a human in life, then we come to know it because there's some sort of useful information out of it. You know, like spirit, for example, they don't give us information that we can't do anything with. Okay, they tend to not do that because it's not
Right.
useful. It's not empowering. So they tend to not do that. So if there was something useful for myself, the immediate universe around me, or the larger universe that we're all part of, in knowing something important about this event that's coming, I'd tend to think that if I needed to know something about it, I would. When I tune into what the significance is, you know, we tend to, because it's a universal event, we're thinking about it on universal terms. But what I've seen, I mean, over and over again, and I think you'll understand this, is that a lot of what we see externally on a global scale, on this larger sort of macrocosm, if we shrink it down to, you know, your family, my family, the people you know, the people that, you know, in your social circle, in your environment, we see the same thing occurring usually on a smaller level. And so it can be really overwhelming to say, you know, what could be done with this information on a global scale? It's even if you were in receipt of it, it's really difficult to elicit action, you know, on how many billions of people. But I can take that same reality and shrink it into my universe and say, what can I do with it there? Because I feel powerful there. I feel like I could have influence there. So for me, that's how I perceive it. I perceive this event as an opportunity to share information about what we could do with it. You know, in to the folks that I have connection or influence with. And so that's what I'm doing with it.
Is it going to do anything to the frequency of our collective in general? Is it helping us with the consciousness shift that's happening?
Well, this is the thing, is that those things don't happen magically, right? But there are changes in universal energies. The frequency around us universally changes, also locally, like on large scale, small scale, individually, and so on. And so we, in order for us to sort of resonate upward, right? Like to have a more coherence with a higher energy, a higher frequency. That doesn't happen magically. And that's the tricky thing, right? It's like it doesn't happen magically. We as individuals with bodies, so we have the emotional body, the mental body, the physical body, we're expressing spirit through us, we're distorting spirit through our personality bodies, which is part of the human experience, which is normal. We actually have to take, you know, dedicated action, both in thought and in doing, to actually make, and truly and genuinely make that shift of resonance upward to a higher frequency. So even if the universal energies change, if we don't change anything, nothing in terms of our own mass connection really changes. So that's the thing that's tricky. You know, if we look at the state of things on a global scale, we have very little influence to the broader community outside of our immediate connections. But I think that that's the key. I think that that's where we have to start. So we can think bigger, and I think we should, because I think it's, you know, often stories only make sense, you know, in light of the larger picture. But I think that it's important on us to, as individuals, you know, if we're looking at conflict globally, right? And it's, you know, thousands and thousands of miles away, and it's an occurrence that we have no connection to, no ability to be connected to. You know, I say scale it back to yourself. Where do you see the same energy of conflict occurring around you? You know, personally, because I think that's where our power is to relate it back to us. And I do believe that if we can all, in some way, view things that way, then we have a reverberation effect. Then we have a much higher frequency, more consistently present around us. And I think that's where our big shifts change. But I think it happens with a number of individuals. You know, there's like a tipping point. It's like a critical mass, right? It's like we have to reach this in order to move into next phase.
And it's just so true because it's the individual that changes the world. It's not a giant group. If without the individual starting and affecting another person and affecting another person until it points, it becomes a movement, it becomes a group. That's the only way change really happens. You mentioned about the world being, there's stuff going on in the world. What's your point of view on why we as a species, we as humanity, are dealing with these old arguments, these old conflicts that are just keep reverberating up out of the soil after we thought it was buried and gone? It just keeps coming up and getting worse. It seems like it's getting worse. I know the 24-hour news cycle doesn't help, but generally speaking, it seems to be getting worse with some of these conflicts coming up out of we're just like I keep saying this on the show. It's like, really, Israel and Palestine? Oh my, again? Like, how? I mean, it's 2,000 years, guys. Like, how are we? How much longer? Or is this going to keep going on? And not taking sides, just saying, guy, this can't. In quote unquote, the holiest land in the world, quote unquote, according to them, this continues to happen. So I'd like to hear your point of view on why all of these conflicts are happening right now, specifically to humanity.
Well, it's a really big question, right? And when I look back, well, first I'll start by saying I'm aware globally of what's going on, but also, and I think I mentioned this in the last time we spoke, I also insulate my own energy. If I take in all of the difficulty that occurs globally around me, I am very affected by it. Because I'm an empath, like most probably folks that are going to be watching this. And sometimes we can guilt ourselves a little bit for not being a spectator. We say, I don't really know what's going on with that. Should I? Everybody's talking about it. And I would just say for those that are sort of in that way of protecting their energy, I'm also with you, and I must do that. I know if I'm here to fulfill purpose that I'm here to do, that I have to take care of myself. I can be a global citizen, but I also know when I need to temper that and not really take it in, and be such a constant observer of it. But it's a really good question. And I thought, if we look back in time, if we look back to maybe like Dark Ages, Middle Ages time periods, right? We're so vastly far away from that, right? Like significantly so. And then, but then I also think about like how many years in, actual calendar years have passed since those time periods, 1,500 years, et cetera. And I think that it's hard sometimes as humans in on like human life scale for us to see larger, the larger time frames that things historically have taken in order for most like that, like a critical number of humanity to evolve. And then I think that this particular time period where we have such a like let's say a larger number of folks sort of operating at this level involved in this conflict, it's a little bit like mind-blowing, right? Like you would agree, right? It's a little bit of a surprise that not a surprise, but it's just it really makes you go, huh? Like where was the lack of evolution for whoever is involved in this, right? Like, what was different there, maybe compared to, folks in other parts of the world? It's really hard to understand. And it is for me too, but from a spiritual perspective, I do understand that, if I think about it as like a human day-to-day level, it's confounding. But if I look at it from a soul perspective and a larger humanity group perspective, I can see that historically, there are generations and generations and generations and groups of people that essentially sacrifice their experience in that life for the larger picture, larger scale evolution, knowing that there were souls that had to sign up for this experience in order for an experience to transpire, for people to observe it and to learn something from it. I also do like I've done I do a lot of work in like cycle pump, which is helping souls that have departed from the physical body but not moved on with the journey. And a lot of times when I work with those souls, sometimes it's in groups and by dozens and hundreds, sometimes in old conflict zones or war areas. And what they all talk to me about is, this idea of, a generation or a group of people or an entire family from a soul perspective signing up for this terrible experience where there's no immediate payoff, or obvious understanding or meaning or purpose for this family or this geographic region of everyone between the ages of 15 and 19. You know, there's no obvious immediate reason, but it's only over the passage of time, and sometimes the time can seem geologic, like it's extremely long. Sometimes the purpose will reveal itself, and that's what I see historically. And so my hope is that although there's extreme suffering in what's going on now, and there has been in so many of these types of occasions in the past, you know, historically in human history, although that is occurring, I have to believe that from a soul perspective, those involved in this, same as the folks that I've worked with, you know, in psychopomp work, they have, for whatever reason, for a larger picture, have signed up for these occurrences so that we will eventually be able to know better, do better, and be better.
You were talking about this psycho, is it psycho, what did you call it?
Psychopomp.
Psychopomp. It sounds like a new form of music, which I'm interested to listen to. But can you dive into that a little bit deeper? Because I've heard of souls not moving on. I mean, that's quote unquote ghosts, if you will.
Right.
My understanding of that is that it's not like they're, and please correct me, it's not like they're trapped in a house or anything like that, but any time, but they're kind of psychically or spiritually connected to that place. They might be in quote unquote heaven, they might be in between lives, but they keep coming back and keep coming. They're not kind of let go of it. That's what I've understood from people I've spoken to. Can you explain to people why certain souls decide or just can't move on?
Sure,
And besides Hollywood's version of why souls can't move on, let's not watch Poltergeist, please, people. But you know what I mean? I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, for sure. There are a number of reasons that a soul does not move on with the journey when it departs the capsule or the vehicle or the body. There are so many. So let's, you know, we will talk about the most common ones. First and foremost, it is possible that a soul is unaware that it has departed the body. So it's like a soul not being aware that its physical function has ceased to exist. So I have encountered, you know, many souls or ghosts over the years that I must inform that they are not animated in life anymore. And you might say, well, how would they not be aware of that? That doesn't make any sense, right? And the best way that I can describe it, especially when I'm teaching students to do spirit rescue work or psychopomp work, is they are in a bit of a state of confusion. Have you ever interacted maybe with a loved one or, you know, a friend that may be struggling mentally with cognition, maybe Alzheimer's or some dementia? It's a very similar experience when you are in communication with a soul that's departed the body but isn't aware that they've passed. And so they're almost sort of like in a sense of like, what's the word? Sort of like Groundhog Day. They really do experience life on repeat, day to day to day. And when I observe them as an energy, sometimes they're going through those motions, you know, and then a few minutes later, I'll observe them again and they're doing the same motion again. So it's sort of like they're unaware and then in a state of confusion and not able to recognize what's really going on. And they sort of move in this cyclical fashion of whatever their soul energy is being animated to do outside of form. So that's one circumstance. Sometimes that can happen when someone makes a very sudden and unexpected departure. And it also depends on, you know, the time lapsed between when there was a death and when the medium makes contact, because all souls eventually will move on, but it can indeed take hundreds of years, and others it's months, others it's days, others it's weeks. It's very different. But a sudden and unexpected departure can catch someone very off guard. And they're unclear as to what's just happened, and they sort of resign to a state of confusion. So that can happen.
Let me
Question?
stop you. So yeah, like a question. So what is the purpose of the soul's evolution to be going through this on a soul level? Because we understand the reincarnation, we understand going through this, and what is the purpose of that experience for the soul? I mean, to be trapped or lost for 500 years. And again, I know time is irrelevant up there. But let's say they're trapped on a battlefield for 500 years or in a house for 500 years. And they truly believe that they're like, why are you in my house? Like in that movie, oh God, what was the movie? With Nicole Kidman, The Others.
Yes, The Others.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, what's a great movie. By the way, I'm a spoiler great alert. Movie. They're the ghosts. But they kept thinking that somebody was haunting them, but they were the
Actually,
ones.
It's a great, that's right. That's a great example of what I was talking about. They're just sort of like unaware of, you know, them not
it was a
being
family.
In form existence. Yeah. Yeah.
It was
exactly.
it was a full family and they were in their house and then people moved in and they were like, wait a minute. No, it was like Beetlejuice too, a little bit like Beetlejuice, what they did in Beetlejuice as well.
Yeah. No, it's a really good question because, and there can't be a singular answer and here's why. It really depends on why the soul has not moved on. So in the case where there's been confusion in that something happened really fast and quickly, there was no time for the actual body to mentally process what happened or what was happening. And so the soul is now confused and isn't sure where to go, what to do. So it kind of it hits this replay. When that happens in terms of like purpose, like why does that happen? You know, my understanding of doing this for so long is that when that happens, it's like a little bit of a glitch in a process. So it's not really serving a function or a purpose, not in a in a meaningful way, not in any appreciable way. It's like sometimes people get hung up on things without being conscious of it. We do it here and we can do it outside of the body as well. Other times, we and answer some of your other questions or giving you other examples of why souls don't move on. Other times souls can have some sort of like proprietary ownership over something or so for example, if someone, you know, ran a business that they were extremely invested in for a very long time, and then they made their departure from the physical world and they didn't want to let go of that. And they have a, you know, a very real intent of making sure that everything still goes okay here. No one's doing anything they shouldn't do. Everyone's safe. It should be run this way. People can have in this, in a ghost sense. So a soul outside of the body, but hasn't, you know, assimilated to the spirit world. They're still invested in and have a vested interest in what's going on here. And when that happens, that's very much by choice. So we still have free will choice outside of the body. So I've encountered a number of ghosts that, you know, I often get called into professional buildings or, you know, studios or theaters and things like that, where there are hauntings taking place. And typically the spirits or the ghosts that I run into in those locations, they are very well aware that they no longer have a body, but feel extremely invested in what's going on here. And then it's my job as the medium to help them to understand that they essentially have zero influence in what's going on here. And also that their time has come and gone. And an important part of spirit rescue oftentimes is helping the soul that's still spirit or form bound or physical world bound to remind them that they have typically family or people or animals that are important to them that are in the spirit world that are waiting for them. And so they've almost like lost touch with that, forgotten about that. And it's part of my job to make a reunion for them. People are usually surprised to find out from me that, you know, unlike what it looks like in movies where you can compel a spirit or a ghost to leave the physical connection.
The power of Christ compels you. Yes, I know.
Yeah, right. So what my experience is, of course, is that, you know, for the most part, and I say for the most part, because sometimes souls, especially the ones that are confused and extremely dull, sometimes they can feel very comatose to you. And then we would sort of like implore help of higher beings of light to retrieve them because they just can't make the process happen themselves. But aside from that, which doesn't happen very often, the ghost, the energy itself has to make its own free will choice to make the transition. They have to choose. You can't make them.
So then let me ask you this, because I've spoken to so many near-death experiencers, and in the process of when they die and those first steps, when these people died and left this realm, there was no tunnel of light. There was nobody there to meet them. Jesus didn't show up and go, come with me, child. There's all these stories. So why hasn't their relatives or their spirit guides or, you know, angels or some sort of other beings from light beings from the other side come over and said, hey, Hey, you're no, time to move on. You don't have to leave, but you can't stay here.
Yeah.
kind of thing. Why didn't
Yeah.
that happen for these
Well,
souls?
I think there are a lot of reports and accounts of that actually happening to people. And then I think that there are accounts where that didn't happen for people. There are lots of folks with near-death experiences that have spoken, even on record, really important, people in some cases talking about having encountered some being. And oftentimes also a tunnel of light, and then other times none of that. So I
Right,
don't think
agreed.
right. So I don't. So I think that it can happen in any number of ways for different people. I can't remember now, so you can't quote me. But I remember a number of years ago doing some NDE research, and so this is where you can't quote me because I can't remember where this was published. But the discussion was about, during early transition of a soul from in the body to outside of the body, there were a number of accounts as part of this research project that talked about, the being that presented or the beings that presented to them at the initial sort of phases or stages of death, typically ended up being beings that they recognized as either like religious figures that they subscribed to or family members. But that if, because some folks describe going further into the spirit world and then coming back out. But beyond that initial phase, there was no hierarchical presence. There was no singular figure of like a god or an avatar figure for them. That kind of they moved past that, transcended it. And what the discussion was about was that we tend to recognize what presents to us if it's a form in some way, so a person or a figure, so that we're not afraid at the beginning of death process. But that ultimately, from a religious perspective, there is no hierarchical presentation of a father and a son and all of these things. But we may perceive that in early transition so that we feel recognition, we feel comfortable, we feel comforted. And then for other folks, there's no experience of that at all.
Interesting. Yeah, because I know, yeah, I agree with you 100% after speaking to so many near-death experiencers. There are common elements, generally speaking, but some come up and they pop right back in. Other ones go and they take a tour of heaven,
That's
or
right.
the other, they take a full tour and they're like in the Akashic records and, oh, this is the healing center. And so there's all sorts of different experiences. But on a soul level, I was always wondering, like, well, if grandma loved me, why didn't she come and pick me up? Like why, if my mom who's passed or my dog, or why didn't they, like, oh, they're obviously lost. Maybe we
Yeah.
should go down there and help them out. That
Well,
just, it's just, it's, I'm just curious why that wouldn't
for
happen.
sure. Yeah, my thoughts on that are this. In the like hundreds of thousands of readings I've done in communication with spirit people,
Sure.
no one has ever not been collected. No one has ever
Eventually.
shown me, eventually, no one has ever shown me their experience of departure of soul coming out of the body and there was nothingness and no one. No one has ever shown me that. But what I will say is that in the context of what we're talking about right now, which is near-death experiences, which is essentially meaning the person came back to life, right? There could very well be an obvious reason that no one showed up for them because it wasn't their time and they weren't going anyway. That's very possible in my mind. That would, to me, would make some sense. Now,
They
the
knew
difficulty
they.
here is like the spirit world knew that they, this is, we're not collecting them. There's no retrieval of soul needed because they're not staying here. This is a temporary experience, blink and back. And so there was no need for it. And that makes sense to me. But I will also caution by saying the spirit world, reality beyond form is infinite. So sometimes these things don't make sense to us, but it's sure nice when they seem to actually maybe have a
Well, yeah.
correlation and actually make sense.
Yeah, our hardware is just not built for the
Right.
ideas that we talk on the show sometimes, just like these large, I mean, even quantum physics, you start talking about, which is now becoming very spiritual in the way that they look at the universe. These concepts are so mad. It's just vast. The universe is endless and infinite, and it's constantly expanding. Wrap your head around that. That's
Right.
insane. Oh, there are no past lives or future lives, where all our lives are happening at the exact same time. And what? Like you can't even turn your head on that.
Yes, very difficult.
So from your experience working with souls that have departed but have not left this realm, have you run across, again, I worked in Hollywood for 30 years, so please bear with me. I've seen way too many movies. Are there angry ghosts? Are there love, like what are the kind of feelings that are there hauntings that, weird things are happening like they do in a haunted house movie? How does that work?
Yeah, I mean, when you encounter a ghost, it feels very unlike what it feels like when you communicate with a transition spirit person. So, for example, your grandmother on the other side, right? Like that feels like, an epitomized idea of love. That's what it feels like communicating with transition spirit people. There's a glow to it, there's a vibration to it, it's extremely high. When you encounter ghosts, very infrequently would they feel sort of neutral, but sometimes they do. For the most part, it will be a lower vibration. And that can include energies that feel like anger, feels like resentment. A lot of the time, untransitioned people have opinions. Whereas if you communicate with a spirit person who is transitioned, they are very unopinionated because they have a deeper, higher understanding of what may need to occur, whether or not they liked it or didn't like it here in the physical world. They have a higher understanding of it now. So they're very unopinionated. They never tell you what to do. Untransitioned spirit people have ideas of what they want or what they would like. You can be very aware and even palpably feel that energy, even if you're not a psychic. I mean, some people will walk into a room or a building and say, ooh, it gives me the heebie-jeebies. I don't know what that is, right? And that's people just recognizing a lower energy presence that's there. Can the spirit world manipulate form? They can. It was funny. We were just talking about Whoopi Goldberg in The Ghost, but you remember the part of the movie where I think it was Patrick Swayze trying really hard to
The
kick a
penny.
pop can or move the
Oh, yeah.
penny, right?
Yeah,
Remember
yeah,
that?
yeah, yeah,
So
yeah.
the spirit world can influence in very small doses the physical world, but very really and truly, our power being animated in form is more powerful than anything a spirit person would be able to do to influence our physical surroundings. But yet they do, and very easily do, influence the energy of it. So yeah, you run into all kinds of low energies that feel super gnarly a lot of the time. And that's why, the type of work, psychopomp or, spirit rescue work, or spirit releasement work, all the same thing. You have to be a really experienced practitioner because sometimes those energies, a lot of times those energies really want to knock you off your kilter, right? So you can stop bothering them, right? They would like to continue to watch over what's going on here, or they might, and sometimes people are haunted. So you could have a soul that felt like a vendetta against you. They were extremely low energy when they were here. They don't want to let go of this and release into, the highest love. They want to see something fulfilled that is per their agenda. Those types of energies would love to not be bothered by anyone. So when you bother them as a medium, you really the reason you have to have, a lot of experience is because you have to hold extreme power. Right? Because if anything about what a non-form being is doing frightens you, you immediately shrink out of your power and you have zero influence over them. You have zero ability for them to buy what you're selling, which is let go of whatever you're grounded to and move on to something better.
So yeah, that makes sense in the sense that, again, talking to near-death experiencers that have had a hellish experience, which does happen. It's mostly it's all butterflies and rainbows with near-death experiences, but sometimes there are hellish ones that people go through, and they say that in the dark, when they go through the dark part, there's always a light being, usually a Jesus form or an avatar of some sort that comes in, and the negative energy just they can't handle that vibration, that frequency, and they have to like kind of come down, grab you, pull you up, and then you have to raise your frequency. That's very fascinating. So it's more ghost, less Ghostbusters.
Although in saying that, I have to do a lot of clearing work that has nothing to do with a discarnate human soul. Okay. So you can have thought forms or other energies, transient globs of energy that are extremely low vibration, extremely suctioning, extremely influential to the people and the places that it occupies. There, a sympathetic resonance can occur between two things, upward or downward. And when we have these low energy beings, either around us personally or in the spaces that we occupy, we can sort of be suctioned down by them. And every time you go into your home, you're like, gosh, I just feel like a super frustrated, exhausted person. And 10 minutes ago before I got here, I felt like I was flying high. And sometimes there's no one as the medium or the person doing the releasement work. There's no person to talk to in non-form. Rather, we have to use our own actual personal energy and combine with other energies to move and manipulate that energy out without having a discussion per se. So it's not always just humans out of form. Sometimes it's sort of, I call them like astral nasties or blobs of energy that are usually an initiator or created as human thought or extreme emotion. Okay, and then it's self-generated by a human and then sort of like projected out from their field, and now it's free roaming. And so there's a lot of transmutation work that has to happen that has nothing to do with actually a human outside of form. So sometimes
Is
it can be
there
a little ghostbustery, is what I mean.
a little bit, but we don't have plasma rifles.
That's right, yeah.
Is there a way, because my understanding of spirit from my research and people I've spoken to is that, especially with angels and also spirit guides and things, but specifically angels, they are dying to help you all the time, but they won't interfere with your free will. But if
That's
you
right.
ask for help, they will come and help you. Is that
Correct.
something that people can do if they are in a situation where they're dealing with a lower energy in a quote unquote haunted house or something like that, or even these blob energies that you're talking about? Can I bring in someone to help protect, help and get me away, things like that?
That's what a great question. Yes, and no. So yes, you can call in angels, helpers, guides, helping spirits to protect you, to try to maintain your energy. Those beings of light on their own don't transmute, either a ghost or maybe a blob of energy. Because again, in a ghost's circumstance, they, through their own free will choice, they need to detach from form, from grounded reality outside of. And so nothing compels them to do that outside of their own free will choice. So you can protect and insulate yourself from that energy, but will those energies get rid of the
No.
contaminating energy? They
Got
won't,
it.
right? And then with all that being said, this can sound like scary sometimes to people, but it's so important to remember the power of your body. You are way more powerful than anything non-form around you. And that's a gift of form. And that helps us to understand if you really realize that, you realize that you really don't have anything to be afraid of. Yes, you can be impacted. Your energy and your personality can even be influenced by an intrusion, either in your own personal energy field or where you are. But beyond that, you're safe. That's the truth of it.
Yeah, there's the Hollywood possessions and things like that.
Right.
That doesn't really, I mean, even in Ghost, she allowed people to come. She was channeling essentially, when the you know she was channeling spirit to come through her, in the most beautiful, hilarious way, that she did
Thank
that
you.
movie. Now this is a fascinating conversation because I've really never gone deep down this the ghost and, soul, spirit, not deciding to transition, because it is something that is, man, it is something that scares the bejesus out of people, to the point where they're, they're burning sage around the house. I'm not sure if that even does anything. You
No, it
tell me it
doesn't.
does.
It doesn't. It doesn't
It
because, as
stinks.
I
It stinks,
said,
though. It does stink.
well,
It does
this is the
stink.
thing. We can be, sometimes there's just a little bit of a lack of education around it where, a tool will do the work. But in reality, this level of work, it requires interface, between you and whatever this is. Or if it's not you, between you and someone else, we want to feel empowered all the time. So it makes sense. Could I use a tool? But in my experience, and I also teach, energy clearing and releasement to lots of students. the first initial concept people have is that, yeah, maybe I could burn some mugwort or whatever that might be, or Palo Santo or what have you, and that'll release and clear. And really, tools like that, while they have value because they at the most surface level can clear something, something that isn't really a deep intrusion or hasn't been there long or is literally like a dusting. If you had a little spat with someone, but it didn't turn into a big fight, for example, you could clear the energy in the room with a tool and it probably will work. But what we're talking about is something much deeper where free will choice is involved and the interface is required. And so tools really don't do anything for that. And that's not to say they don't serve a purpose, but for what we're talking about, they really don't. It really doesn't do anything. And that's probably why, probably lots of folks that are going to listen to our podcast today are going to talk about, well, that makes sense. I did this ritual and burned this or, sprayed this. And I felt like it felt good right after. And then the next day, I felt like whatever was there was still there. And this is why.
So you mean holy water, not so much?
It's the same idea. Holy water is no different than burning Palo
I'm
Santo
joking.
or if you're burning sage
Yeah,
or,
I'm joking.
whatever it is. Yeah, but that's exactly
Right.
right. Yeah.
It's fascinating because you're the first time I've heard you say or heard anyone say that those entities have free will. There are souls who have free will, and free will is, to my understanding, the ultimate law in the universe. Once you're given free will, they do not intrude on that free will. Angels don't do it. People on the other side don't do it. Spirit, no one interferes with your free will. You have the choice to crash and burn or fly. It's up to you completely. But I never thought about a ghost also having free will. I'm like, no, I don't want to go. I think Walt
Well, I
Disney's
mean,
haunting
right?
Disneyland. Walt Disney's haunting Disneyland, obviously. He's in Cinderella's castle and he's like, no, I'm just going to make sure this all runs. And I'm sure he's pissed off by a few things that have happened with his company over the years. But if they choose to stay, it's their choice. And it's their
That's right. A
choice to
soul is
interact
a
with me.
soul, whether it's in a body or out of a body, right? A soul is a soul in a body or out of a body. And so that
Right.
doesn't change. It really doesn't change.
And that you do have the ability to insulate yourself from the energy, but it will not affect the energy is a
Correct.
very important distinction for people because they think like, I'm gonna bring in my Archangel Michael, and he's that big sword I see in him, and he's gonna take care of
Yeah.
this. That's not the way that works.
It doesn't work like that. I mean, I wish it did work like that because it would make things a lot easier, not only for us, but for the souls that, in their neutral state or their natural state, they aren't a low energy, but they have been so damaged by the lifetime they just came out of. Based on those experiences that were part of, their soul's plan, but it was extremely damaging. I mean, they want to have a return, whether they're conscious of it or not conscious of it, they want to have a return to the universe too. And when I'm teaching psychics and mediums to do this work, I make sure to talk about the fact that those energies, although they may seem very low energy, and they are, and they're very damaged, I also have found in my work that all energy essentially wants to make a return to whatever its natural state was, which is a state of neutrality. And then we become imbued by things here and there and through experiences here and through a life, et cetera. And so I really have found that because there is always, it's like energy is always wanting to evolve. It's always wanting to change. It's not wanting to stay the same. There's this constant motion of energy, and the same is true for the souls that are still earthbound, right? But they aren't aware of it, a lot of them. It's but unconsciously they want to, which is often what can draw those energies to mediums, because we can be a source of that transmutation for them. Okay, it's like, so we notice them. So because we notice them, they are interested in us, and they may then come into our energy, even if we don't want them to. But it's really not to be, in my view, it's not to be malicious, but unconscious, they want to make the return to the universe, but they're so sort of contaminated by low energy that they've created an experience in this life that they can't articulate it. It's like they don't really know it, but the soul itself is striving to get there. And we're a vehicle to make that happen. And that's why spirits or ghosts, correction, can be drawn to the energy of psychics and mediums, because we would be a route of transmutation for them, because we will notice them. And even if we don't know what to do with them, we'll find out how to.
Would dealing with a ghost or dealing with an entity that has not moved on, is that part of the karma of the person and of the entity as well?
It could be. I mean, I can't say that it would or would not be. From a human, like an animated life perspective, the medium or the psychic here, do I think that that presented very synchronistically for them to have an opportunity to experience that? Yes. Could it be karmic? If it's karmic, I just don't believe it's like sent an idea of a sentence. If a soul has not transitioned and they're grounded to form, I don't feel like they're relegated by some force to be that way. I think that's part of their karmic choosing, whether they're immediately aware of it or not. And I think that that's important too. And it also demonstrates our free will choice that still exists. And I think maybe the last thing I'd say about it is that I have in my life many times encountered spirits that are grounded to form. So they're attached to either a location, a person, an idea here in the physical world still, that are not low energy. They're not angry. They're not opinionated in a sort of like startling sense. They really loved this place. It was, when I think of one in particular, I mean, there were so many, but one in particular, there was a woman who, with her husband at the same time, were killed in a car crash. And they had a rural farm business that they put their whole entire life into. And, everything that ever identified any of them, either of them, had to do with this farm. And suddenly they were gone. And maybe a year later, I was called in to do an energy clearing of the farm property because the new tenant felt stalked a little bit and felt like she is having someone watch over her literally all the time. And it was so uncomfortable. And when I came to do the clearing, the husband of the property, he in fact had moved into the spirit world. He had transitioned, but the wife, the woman proprietor, had not. Extremely invested, wanting to make sure everything was just so done right by the animals, done right by the land. And she was so invested in it that it was so difficult for her to withdraw from it. But she wasn't angry about it. She wasn't, when you think of like, a haunting, it wasn't like she was trying to hurt anyone or had any bad ideas. She just loved this place so much and wanted to stay connected to that reality. And so when I, did the releasement, it really what I had to do was assure her of a few things. One was that there is much more for her to experience beyond this. One, two, the current tenant agrees to take the best care of this place that she could, and that seemed to pacify the ghost. That the new tenant was committed to whatever it took to make this successful, but ultimately it's her journey, and we have to let her live that. So there isn't always, a haunting isn't always something that feels like you've got something to be afraid of. Sometimes like the story is deeper and more loving than that, and it's just an unfortunate situation where a soul needed some help to let go of this reality to give them a glimpse of what's beyond, which is much better for them.
Have you ever dealt with a walk-in soul in your work?
What, sorry?
A walk-in soul.
Walk in, like walk into me?
No, walk into like so my understanding is there sometimes when someone dies in a near-death experience, the
Okay.
soul decides to leave. And there's another soul's like, oh, that's a good body. I don't want to go through childhood again. I'll
Oh.
just jump in and then take
No, I
over. Have you ever heard
yes,
of
I know
that?
what you mean now. Yes, I haven't heard that terminology. No, I have never encountered that. I also think that if that has ever occurred historically, it would be extremely, extremely
Rare.
rare. However, we can also misidentify that. And here's what I mean by that. I have worked with a number of folks living who have had near-death experiences, and when or and even if it weren't near death, they would have been in a situation where folks would have said, you should have died there, but you didn't. Okay, so like a catastrophic car crash and et cetera. There are a number of folks who have experienced that, and when they make their either return back to the body or return to life as normal, feel like radically and totally different people. But as a
Yeah, that's
soul,
different.
they are the same, but they've
Sure.
had a radical transformation through experience. So sometimes we could maybe misidentify. And I actually have. I remember working with someone a number of years ago who wasn't sure she was the same person pre and post. And through exploration of her Akashic records and looking at her soul's blueprint and her process, she is the same, but the radical transformation feels so immensely different from before that it feels like you can't even identify with who you were pre.
That happens as well, no question. Now, Marianne, we've been having this very casual conversation about ghosts and spirits and clearings and things like that, and very casual. I'm assuming that somebody watching, if they're still watching, they're curious, and that's why they're watching. But I gotta believe you've run into a couple of naysayers, a couple of pessimists about this. What do you say to people who are going, "These two people are absolutely insane. What are you talking about? This is crazy." I'm sure you run into this all the time. Like, she's nuts. He's nuts for just talking about this stuff. What would you say to these people?
Well, I could give you two answers. One would be good for our show, so that allows us to have dialogue.
Yeah.
Okay, that one, so I'll revisit that. But my more truthful response to that would be I have no responses for that because I'll tell you why. It's such a draw on one's own personal energy to invest in explanation or pitching of or trying to enlighten someone on a subject matter where there is no receptivity to it anyway. So it feels like a total waste of my energy to do that. And I typically don't fall into that trap. I mean, not typically, I don't. I just don't. Because I feel like, and there's no right or wrong to it. I'm not right. And a skeptic or a pessimist is not wrong. We know
Yeah.
what we know based on our own experiences. And I think it's important to honor that. But also be open. So if an energy is closed enough to say this is total baloney and prove it, then I feel no need to accommodate that request. So I think maybe that would be my answer.
So it's basically, a vegan trying to tell a meat eater, "You gotta stop eating steak. It's just not good. It's why even waste your time?"
Why bother? Yeah, exactly.
Or
And
stay,
that, but in, on
or the
that
other one.
note, I have met, I mean, I work with a lot of professionals in the form of me. So as a medium, I work with a lot of professionals. So doctors, lawyers, politicians, actors, et cetera. And a lot of folks that I work with that are like very, very left-brained, very, very mathematic
Grounded.
and,
Yeah.
grounded and needing things to be very demonstrable and connect A to Z. I have worked with a lot of folks like that. I myself am actually naturally wired that way. But a lot of those folks, self-identify that, 10 years ago I was talking to you, I would, back away and be afraid or not want to interface, right? But I trust that if a soul needs to, become aware of a reality that they currently aren't aware of or don't subscribe to or don't believe in, and then I believe it'll show up for them like it has for many people, who in their lives were skeptical of anything that couldn't be named or videotaped or heard or seen. And then they have a direct experience that they can't explain, and that will lead them into a pathway that's appropriate for them. And I am never going to be the person that's going to try to open that pathway for them because the timing is not optimal. It's optimal when it shows up for you, not because someone's bringing it to your table.
I love that answer. That's a beautiful, beautiful answer because you're absolutely right. Everyone's got their own path. And everyone, I mean, if they're watching this show, there's a curiosity. If they're watching this episode and they've stayed this long, there's a curiosity. There's something going on. Marianne, it's been such a pleasure talking to you as always. Where can people find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing in the world?
Sure. Well, thanks for having me because I love having these conversations with you. My website
Yeah.
is mariannekennedy.ca. And social media is spiritual media Marianne Kennedy. Of course, everyone knows there are so many impersonating accounts, which is so difficult on social media these days. So I always say link to my social media through the website so that you really get to the real me and not a number of impersonating pages, but that's where you can find everything about me is on my website.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Yeah, it's been these things come up as themes. And this week so far, the theme and messaging from spirit is to like claim and stay in your power, however it is that you need to get there. I think
And
that's
that's a
so
beautiful.
important. Like don't play small, play big, play you.
Beautiful, beautiful. Marianne, thank you again so much for being on the show, and I appreciate what you're doing to help awaken the planet. So thank you, my dear.
Thank you, Alex.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.